is in our standing position, may I request the studio to please play the national anthem, after which we'll take the landmark university anthem. Studio. The Vice Chancellor, please permit me to invite my colleague, Dr. Adaptos, to the microphone to perform the next assignment. Dr. Adaptos, please.
Thank you, Mrs. President. The Chancellor, sir, may I establish the protocol for the third inaugural lecture of Landmark University. The Chancellor and Chairman Board of Regents Landmark University, Dr. David Oyedepo, the Vice President Education Living Faith Church Worldwide, Pastor Mrs. Faith Oyedepo, the esteemed members of Board of Regents Landmark University, Education Secretary Living Faith Church Worldwide, Professor Bridget Shaw, the Vice Chancellor Landmark University, Professor Isaac Obayan, the Vice Chancellors of other universities here present, the Registrar Landmark University, Dr. John Isabel, other Principal Officers of Landmark University, Deans of Colleges and the School of Postgraduate Studies, members of CINEC Landmark University, the Distinguished Inaugural Lecturer, Professor Makonjola Oki, my Lords, spiritual and temporal, esteemed guests, kings and queens of Landmark University, members of the Fourth Estate of the Realm, distinguished ladies and gentlemen, you are all welcome to the third inaugural lecture of Landmark University. Today's lecture is entitled "The Tripodal Connection: Man, Material and the Environment, Agricultural Inputs in Corrosion." This lecture promises not only to be interesting but also engaging. The Chancellor, sir.
No shake my
hand. May I at this juncture invite the Registrar of Landmark University, Dr. John Zebran, to make the introductions. The registration. Thank you, Mr. Henry. My job this afternoon is to introduce members of the high table. To my far right, on left, is the Dean of College of Science and Engineering, Dr. John Ojejiro. Next to him is the representative of the Dean of College of Business and Social Sciences, Dr. Festus Ashamu. Next to him is the Dean of the Proposed School of Postgraduate Studies, Professor Omu-Aran. Now to my very far right, we have the Director of Center for Learning Resources, Mrs. Felicia Yusuf. We also have Dr. Agatos, the HOD and the Master of Events for this evening. We have representative of the HOD of Mechanical Engineering. You're welcome, sir. We have the chaplain of the university, Pastor Tunde Adekoye. We have the Dean of Student Affairs, Dr. Arisuku Odadimbo. We have the Director of the Financial Services, Pastor Frederick Arahua. And may I please ask that you rise up as I introduce my Vice Chancellor, Professor Isaac O'Brien. Put your hands again together, please. Please, you may be seated. My name is John Severi, the Acting Registrar of Landmark University. You are welcome. Thank you, sir, for that introduction. The Chancellor, sir, may I respectfully invite the Vice Chancellor of Landmark University, Professor Isaac O'Brien, for the welcome remarks. The Vice Chancellor, please, you may rise.
Of the third inaugural lecture of Landmark University to welcome all our distinguished guests to Landmark University. May I, by way of staying with the protocols already rolled out, recognize the Chancellor of Landmark University, Chairman Board of Regents Landmark University, Dr. David Oyedepo, the Vice President of Education, Living Faith Church Worldwide, Pastor Mrs. Faith Oyedepo, esteemed members of the Board of Regents, Landmark University, the Education Secretary, Living Faith Church Worldwide. I recognize today Vice Chancellors here present, registrars here present, the Registrar of Landmark University, other principal officers of Landmark University, members of Senate, ladies and gentlemen, and here kings and queens in Landmark University. I observe all other protocols on this occasion. It is with great excitement that I welcome us all to today's inaugural lecture, holding today the 9th of February 2017. The inaugural lecturer, none other than Professor Malcolm Juola Oki, of the Department of Mechanical Engineering, College of Science and Engineering, Landmark University. He will be speaking to a very important, very relevant subject matter, the tri-modal connection, man, material, and environment, agricultural input in corrosion. I give God praise for being an indispensable source, and everything that will be packaged in today's lecture, and also for sustaining all that has been going on the Landmark University context. We've had the first, the second, and now the third, noting the age of Landmark University and the vital platform that inaugural lectures represent, where we have new professors come to speak to their research and the contributions and the impacts they'll be making in the course of their being introduced aboard the professorate. Universities are certainly duty-bound to create, advance, and disseminate knowledge and push the frontiers of knowledge. That is what we'll be seeing this afternoon as Professor Malcolm Juwala Oki speaks to the subject matter already mentioned. We know that this is a crucial university town event and a public program where the annals of our history, where the annals of our vision connects with that which the resources of the university's base. And this is what today's lecture will be rolling out. The inaugural lecture certainly is a rite of passage where an academic, particularly a new professor, is inaugurated into the professorate. And not just the professorate of Landmark University, but the professorate globally. We are glad today with this lecture, Professor Oki will be so formally recognized. Landmark University is driven by a very compelling vision to spearhead an agrarian revolution. Our research emphasis, our inaugural lecture emphasis, among other things, is to drive solutions for agricultural developments in Nigeria, on the continent, and globally. And therefore, on the occasion of today's third inaugural lecture, present our very own Professor Malcolm Juwala Oki. Very shortly, his citation will be read and a formal presentation on this platform. May I also congratulate him on this academic feat as he delivers his inaugural lecture today, and by doing so, he will be discharging his academic obligation to Landmark University, as well as make contributions from the space of the subject matter to the world at large. By the grace of God, from today's inaugural lecture, a number of specific contributions will be rolled out from the Covenant, I beg your pardon, did I say Covenant, from the Landmark University context. I'd like to welcome us all, and I again do this on behalf of the Chancellor of Landmark University, Dr. David Oyedepo, doing this on behalf of the Board of Regents, also doing this on behalf of the management, members of Senate, and all of you distinguished ladies and gentlemen. Let us sit back and have a wonderful outing on the occasion of the third inaugural lecture of Landmark University. May I especially recognize Mrs. Sobari Oki, the best half and only half of Professor Malcolm Juwala Oki. Members of his family as well are welcomed on this occasion, his mentors, academic mentors, and every well-wisher gathered together this afternoon. Welcome all. God bless you. Thank you.
Another round of applause for that beautiful remark from the Vice Chancellor of Landmark University. The Chancellor, sir, we are about to unveil the third inaugural lecturer of Landmark University. And to perform that task, may I invite Dr. Daniel Oguru-Okore to read the citation of the third inaugural lecturer, Landmark University, Professor Makonjola, Dr. Oguru. Put your hands together.
The Chancellor, sir, may I respectfully request our inaugural lecturer, Professor Makonjola Oki, to rise and remain standing while his citation is read. The Chancellor, sir, Professor Makonjola Oki was born in Lagos Island, into the family of Mr. R.M.A. Oki and Mrs. J.A. Oki Lee George. He attended three primary schools, severally and in series, namely Methodist Primary School, Surulere, Lagos, St. Teresa's Catholic Parish School, Jos, and St. Paul's Catholic School, Ebutemeta, Lagos. He later attended Stella Maris College, Okitipupa, where he obtained the West African School Certificate in Division 1 in A's, or with A's in five subjects. In his undergraduate days as a federal government scholar in the University of Benin, he studied industrial chemistry and graduated with a second class upper division degree. Professor Oki had his mandatory NYSC scheme at the Kaduna Polytechnic, where he taught mathematics in the Department of Mathematics and Related Sciences. On completion of the service year, he joined the University of Port Harcourt as a graduate assistant, from where later in the same year proceeded to University of Manchester Institute of Science and Technology, UK, for his postgraduate studies under the sponsorship of University of Port Harcourt. He was at the foremost corrosion and protection center in Europe under the tutelage of the first professor of corrosion science and engineering in the UK, Professor Graham Charles Wood of blessed memory. Professor Oki obtained his MSc degree in corrosion science and engineering, materials and metallurgical engineering in 1982, and PhD in corrosion engineering in 1985. On completion of his studies, he returned to the University of Port Harcourt and served the mandatory 5 years bond before stepping aside to put his knowledge of corrosion to use in the industries. Professor Oki, in conjunction with some friends, floated Solman Industrial Services Limited, where he was in charge of corrosion, environmental protection services, and conversion coating solutions to the metal finishing industries. His PhD finding in conversion coating chemicals was successfully put into the Nigerian market as Solmacro. The Chancellor, sir, Professor Oki served as an adjunct senior lecturer in the Department of Chemical Engineering and Polymer Technology, Lagos State University, and later as one of the pioneer program leaders at the National Open University of Nigeria. He also taught in several tertiary institutions in the UK. Professor Oki has published several papers in various local and international journals. He is the author of the book, Corrosion and Control in Industries, 2015, and co-author of Corrosion and Materials in the Oil Industry, 2013. He is the patent holder of functionalized chromate conversion coating, patent number NG/2013 /755, April 2014. Professor Okeh is a recipient of many awards, including Nigerian universities linkages with expats and academics in diaspora scheme 2010 to 2012. Nigerian Corruption Association's Professional Development Award 2016, and various awards for excellence in the four avenues of service by Rotary Club of Agbara between 1995 and 2012. Professor Makonjo Okeh is happily married to Sobari L. Okeh, and they are blessed with three fantastically brilliant children. The Chancellor, sir, may I request this distinguished assembly to rise as I present Professor Makonjola Okeh, Professor of Materials and Metallurgical Engineering, for his inaugural lecture.
Shall we all be seated? Bishop David Oyedepo, the Vice President, Education, Living Faith Church Worldwide, Pastor Mrs. Faith Oyedepo, the esteemed members of the Board of Regents, Landmark University, the Education Secretary, Living Faith Churchwide, Professor Bridget Shogun, the Vice Chancellor, Professor Isaac Obanyan, the Registrar, Pastor John O. Izebere, PhD, other principal officers of Landmark University, Deans of Colleges and School of Postgraduate Studies, members of Senate, Landmark University, my Lord Spiritual and Temporal, esteemed guests, kings and queens of Landmark University, ladies and gentlemen of the Fourth Estate of Urebe, distinguished ladies and gentlemen. The topic for discourse today has been read out: the tripolar connection, man, material, environment. Juxtaposed on these is the input from agricultural products. But before I go ahead, I will first of all read the dedication. This work, first and foremost, is dedicated to the tripod, which forms the base of Christianity. The Holy Trinity, God the Father, God the Son, and God the Holy Spirit. God has been wonderful in my life and those of my family members. And secondly, I dedicate this to my children, Omi, Muiwa, Kaya, of whom I am inordinately proud, and their mother, Sombami, for their cast iron, unflinching support, love, and admiration. have given the dedication, and I will now go ahead to discuss the topic for today. Well, like I said earlier, the topic of the day is the tricorder connection. Man, material, and the environment. I am going to take each and every word of the topic before I go to the main discourse for the day. So, as a form of introduction, I'll tell you that it is customary for Nigerian universities to invite professors to give inaugural lectures. Inaugural lectures are different from the lectures we give day to day to your students. With inaugural, there is no replay. As I am talking to you today, the MP of the day will not give you permission to ask me any question. But not with my students. Anytime I'm lecturing, they can say, "Sir, I do not understand. I didn't hear you," and things of that nature. It doesn't happen with inaugurals. So I will stick to the rules of inaugural lectures by giving you the truth as they are in my profession, which is corruption, and what we have added to the study or the understanding of corruption. So I'll start by discussing man. And how do we start by discussing man without reference to the big book, that is the Bible? We go to the very first chapter of the Bible, the very first three verses. In there, and I quote, "In the beginning, God created the heaven and the earth. And the earth was without form and void. And darkness was upon the face of the waters. And God said, let there be light. And there was light." Have we ever wondered why God created light? Why is it that it was light that he first created? The answer is not far-fetched. If there is no light, photosynthesis will not take place. Plants will not grow, we won't have agricultural produce, and even man and the materials and even animals, they cannot survive without the sun. Why? Free source of vitamin D. Although you can get some vitamin D in some plants or foods, but the one you get from the sun is as good as any other one, and it is the best anyway. And what are the deficiencies? What will be the result of deficiency in vitamin D? Osteoporosis in man and in youths or babies, what do you get? Rickets. And there are so many other diseases associated with deficiency or inadequacy of vitamin D. So, God, in his infinite mercy, did the right thing. He gave us light first, so that all other creations can survive. Without plants, without agricultural produce, none of us will survive. So, and in any case, if we go on further to look at Genesis chapter 1, verse 27, that one reads, "So God created man in his own image. In the image of God created he him, male and female created he them. Then he gave man dominion over all creations." That was on the sixth day. And on the seventh day, what happened? He rested. However, in his perfection, as human beings and animals, whatever we bring out or during metabolism, Most of the air we breathe out is carbon dioxide laden. What happens? Plants make use of this gas in producing food and the rest. So whatever is the outcome from A, B takes it up. And there is a balance. Ecosystem was balanced. No tilt to negative end of environmental pollution. And everything worked clockwise. However, as man started to create materials, he has never gotten the rest up to the present day. As he is creating materials, he is trying to develop them, to improve on them. As he is improving on them, he is causing more pollution to the environment. Industrialization came in. With industrialization, you have environmental pollution. And the world tilted to the negative end of environmental stability. Then, all of a sudden, we started hearing about, pollution here, pollution there, water table rising, and the rest of it. And what we have? A phrase, carbon footprint. And what does that mean? That one joined the lexicons of environmentalists. In other words, the more man pollutes the environment in terms of energy consumption, the higher is the carbon footprint. And what can we do to sort out this negative carbon footprint? We only have to sit down at our different corners and watch the extent to which we make use of energy. If you cut down your own energy footprint, carbon footprint, I cut down mine, we are adding in no small measure to environmental stability. Now, we have seen man, we have seen materials. We are going to talk about materials. Materials can be divided into two. You have the metals and non-metals. We all know about non-metals. We know that concrete, plastic, polymer, and the rest. These are non-metals. As for metals, we can divide metals into two. And we say ferrous materials and non-ferrous materials. Why do we say ferrous and non-ferrous materials? The answer is not far-fetched. Iron and its alloys form 95% of metal world production, with aluminium and its alloys coming in a distant second. So, and materials, they are so important to our civilization. The journey of man into civilization has been marked at different stages. We had the Stone Age, we had the Iron Age, Copper Age, and the rest of the ages. With the Stone Age, what happened? Man was able to create arrows, arrowheads, and sharp edges to combat animals and the rest of it. Beyond that, he was able to strike two stones together to make fire, because after eating raw meat and raw corn for some time, he now understood that, well, if I cook these things, they may be more palatable. So he created fire by striking two stones together. Beyond striking two stones together, the next important age was the Iron Age. With the Iron Age, there was rapid development in infrastructures. You had the railway lines, you had buildings, bridges, and the rest of it. That was the 18th and 19th century. So beyond that, we've had so many other ages. But now, we are in the information age. But between the Stone Age and Iron Age, We had Copper Edge, we had the Bronze Edge. Don't wonder for too long why we had copper before iron. Copper is very, very docile when it comes in combining with oxygen. You can easily find the copper in nature. And even if it is combined with any other thing, by just mere roasting, you can always get copper in a purer form. The other metal that we can think about, which comes a distant second to iron and steel, is aluminium. And like I said, since we are now in the information age, the material scientists and engineers, they have come up with different sort of materials. And with the development in materials, we once had a laptop, we had a tabletop, from tabletop to laptop to palm top. And in any case, everything, all our gadgets became raised. There is a photograph somewhere there that shows the first programmed computer. It can take about a quarter of this hall. And imagine, it's there on the screen. Imagine all those things there being put into this palm top. This one can do better than what you have on the screen. So that is what materials, science and engineering had able to add to civilization. But we give kudos to the engineers who made use of these different materials in these fields of engineering. Now, let's look at the environment. What is the environment? The environment is the air we breathe in and out, the obnoxious gases being pumped into the atmosphere by different industries and the rest of them. And when you have rainwater mixing with some of these obnoxious gases, you end up with what is called acid rain. What is acid rain? We all know that acids are very injurious to man and to the materials created by man. So, if you interact with the acid rain, of course, aging of the materials become faster, and even man will age faster. Now let's look at the agricultural inputs into corrosion. What are the products that we make using corrosion as agricultural inputs? We have different leaves. Several researchers, they have looked into extracts from leaves, roots, seeds, and the rest of them of plants. And they've been able to make use of them as corrosion inhibitors. What are inhibitors? Inhibitors are chemicals when added to a corroding system. At least they give a level of support, a level of protection to the metal under investigation. So we have been able to look at different plants, their roots, the backs, and the rest of them. All the phytochemicals that are present in these plants have been used to reduce the rate at which corrosion occurs. Now, I'll now have a look at corrosion. As an engineering scientist, a professional of many years now, my PhD is about 31 years old now, I would define corrosion as a degradation or deterioration of materials of construction. In the past, you talked about corrosion of metals. Now, we have updated the definition and we say materials of construction. Human beings too are made of materials. So human beings, they corrode as well. We have defined corrosion as an aging process because man, materials, they age. And in one manner or the other, we can protect each and every one of these materials by one form or the other. Buildings require maintenance painting. Human beings too require maintenance as a result of aging. Because you don't want to age faster, there are old age related diseases. And what do? You maintain yourself. You inhibit the corrosion process in human beings by taking multivitamins and the rest of them so that you look younger. And you rub some oily materials and things so that the skin will continue to shine. These are maintenance procedures for human beings. In terms of metals and materials created by human beings, we look at these methods and some other ones. We look at cathodic protection, we look at anodic protection, we look at painting and the rest of it. However, as we go ahead to give another definition of corrosion, when you look at metals in particular, you now say it is the reverse of extractive metallurgy. Extractive metallurgy in the sense that from the ore, you pump in some money to bring the ore out of Mother Earth. After spending so much amount of money, you spend money, energy to extract the metal. Beyond that, you spend money, energy, mix it with some other elements to give you a particular form of alloy. And after getting that alloy, you fabricate, you make pipes, you make very big bodies and the rest of it. All this, it costs a fortune. However, immediately you put this material into the environment for service, it starts degenerating without looking back. It starts reacting with the environment. If there is acid rain, the corrosion rate is accelerated. If it is just atmospheric corrosion, it will go gradually, but definitely going back to its ore or a component of the ore. However, the corrosion pattern that we see most of the time is that you see the rusty surface because it is reddish brown. You say, it's rusted. Yes, iron and its alloys, they rust. Rusting is another name for corrosion. All other metals, they corrode. So the generic name is corrosion. However, some of these other metals, their corrosion products are not as brightly colored as that of iron and steel. Steel, they still go back to their ores. There are two types of corrosion. There is the aqueous corrosion and there is the high temperature corrosion. Some researchers call high temperature corrosion, they say dry corrosion. And I say it is a misnomer. There is nothing dry about that process. It is an interaction between fluids, gases. Metal will melt, it flows. So what is dry about it? High temperature corrosion is the name. And the other one is aqueous corrosion. That is the one we see every day. That is the one we interact with. So, with aqueous corrosion, I will tell you that it has been proved beyond peradventure. That is beyond all reasonable doubt that it is electrochemical. The mechanism is based on electrochemistry. And we can describe it with a triangle. There is what we call the corrosion triangle, and that's in there. A is the anode, C is the cathode, E is the environment. Because we know the mechanism of this type of reaction, once you know the mechanism of something, you can always interact with it for good or for bad. If I want corrosion to accelerate, I know what to do because I know that with the triangle, if I fiddle with it, play around with it, corrosion rate will increase. Because I don't want corrosion rate to increase, I want to decrease it. I know that with this tripod, if I remove any leg of the tripod, I will stop Commission practically and theoretically. So if we have a look at the diagram, E stands for the environment. How do I remove E from the tripod? I paint the surface. Once I paint the surface, I have removed the electrolyte. Once there is no electrolyte, there won't be corrosion. But some of you may ask me, oh, my car was painted 2 years ago or 3 years ago, it's corroding and things like that. Yes, there is no coating that doesn't have pin holes. And in corrosion parlance, we call pin holes, we call them holiness. So the time your car will start to corrode depends on the network of these holiness in the paint. And the pinhole too is determined by the polymer backbone of the paint. Now, I can remove the environment by painting. I can remove the anode by applying cathodic protection. What is cathodic protection? Just flood the surface of the material with electrons from the suitable source. So instead of the cathode asking for electrons from the structure, the electrons are there already, so corrosion will not occur. So in practice, and theoretically, we reduce it to zero, that is corrosion to zero. If you remove the cathode, you are applying anodic protection. What do you do? Increase the current beyond critical corrosion current density, and the corrosion rate falls. Once it passes the critical corrosion current density, the corrosion rate will decrease. To apply resistance in the path of ions, what do? You apply inhibitors. Inhibitors, like I told you, we have made use of some extracts from plants to limit corrosion rate. So the use of inhibitor and the use of conversion coatings are the main thrust of my discussion today. Well, we can also have a look at corrosion in agricultural environments. Corrosion in agricultural environments is just that it is accelerated as a result of the chemicals that you come across in agric. You make use of fertilizers. Fertilizers, when they are dry, they don't corrode. But because they are hygroscopic, they absorb moisture from the air. Once they become liquid, they accelerate corrosion. So, corrosion in agricultural settlements is not different from any other corrosion. It's just that it happens more rapidly as a result of the chemicals you come across. And what can you do in agric settlements? You have the inhibitors, you have the oil. Extract oil from seeds of probably jatropha or castor. Extract phytochemicals from plants, probably their roots or leaves, or mix them together and apply it to your implements and the machinery in agriculture. And of course, they will slow down the corrosion. So we can say you can do integrated corrosion control in any farming settlement or agricultural industry you find yourself. However, good housekeeping is of the essence when you are talking about corrosion control. Because if you use this implement to carry acid and you leave it overnight, of course it's going to corrode fast. Why not just clean it up and apply oil or something, and then you slow down the corrosion rate. Now that we are talking about inhibitors find applications in various industrial situations, such as cooling water systems and device. We can define inhibitors and say they can be grouped into two. You have the organic and the inorganic. The organic and inorganic, the synthesized ones, they have problems with the environment. The inorganic ones, they are carcinogenic. So corrosion scientists, what are they looking at? They are now looking at agricultural products. Why? Because they are environmental friendly. They are biodegradable. They do not accumulate into the atmosphere. But there is a drawback with extras from the clients. The drawback is that they cannot stand the time of performance. You use them, you have to repeat, pumping more and more into the system on a regular basis. So, as a rule of thumb, when you are looking at organic inhibitors, they must contain nitrogen, oxygen, sulfur, and the rest of it. Why? Because they carry electron charges with which they can interact with the metals and reduce the corrosion rate. So, what have we done when we are looking at inorganic and organic inhibitors? Because organic and inorganic inhibitors, they inhibit corrosion by adhering to the surface of the corroding metal. And I did talk about aluminium. Aluminium is a particular alloy, are particularly resistant to painting. So what you do is that you first of all prepare the surface of the aluminium and the silver before applying an organic coating. So what have we done? Inorganic coating that we have been using contain chromium. Chromium is carcinogenic. How do we eliminate it? We have not been able to eliminate it completely, but what did we do to see that we improve on the carbon footprint of the metal finishing industry? We took a particular chemical, studied it, used it to coat aluminium. After coating it, we studied the mechanism. The mechanism is such that chromium 6 will return to chromium 3. So any other chemical that will replace chromium must contain a particular compound which has two or more oxidation states. And what did we do? We tried so many other ones, zirconium and the rest of them, molybdenum, vanadium, and the rest. They have not been able to compare in terms of corrosion resistance and paint adhesion with chromium. However, while trying to replace the chromium, I'll say, why don't we look at another process so that the interaction of man and this dangerous chemical can be reduced? So we now look at another process. We now look at tannin. Tannin is, you can extract tannin from onion and from some other plants. It's a phytochemical. You are now looking for a synergistic action from an organic and an inorganic chemical. What we found was so surprising. We found out that there was a golden colored material on the metal we dipped into a mixture of tannin and chromium. This is interesting. After studying the chemical further, we were able to convert it into a conversion coating chemical. The conversion coating chemical dries faster than the normal chromate chemical. And we say, if it can do that, then we can cut down on the process. I will now show you a diagram of a coating establishment. Well, because you have to coat aluminium, you need to prepare the surface to receive the chemical, the conversion coating chemical. So the conversion coating chemical, before you put the conversion coating chemical, you first of all degrease. What do we mean by degrease? You remove the grease. You etch. Maybe you use sodium hydroxide or any alkaline. And beyond that, you rinse. After rinsing, what do? You now apply the conversion coating chemical. After applying the conversion coating chemical, you dry. After drying, it goes into the painting booth. This is a quoting line. There is a pre-treatment section. So what we did was to reduce the carbon footprint of the pre-treatment section. I have blown up the pre-treatment section into block diagrams. As the coil is coming from the decoiler, you do the greasing, etching, water rinse, you dismiss with acid, you rinse, then you conversion coats. Final rinse. The final rinse will contain a lot of chromium 6. Then it goes into the drying section. After the drying section, you paint. This is the normal one. So when we looked at inhibitors, we looked at tannin as an organic inhibitor, chromium as an inorganic inhibitor. We mixed it at a certain ratio. We were able to remove the final water rinse and the drying section. Why is it important to remove the water rinse, the final water rinse? Because the effluent there contains a lot of chromium 6. Chromium 6 is carcinogenic. So once you remove that one, you have removed human interaction with a potential carcinogen. When you remove the drying, you have removed the money you pay to NEPA. What they call themselves nowadays. And if you remove water lines as well, you remove the money with which you treat the effluent before pushing it out into the bodies of water. So what we have done was to reduce the carbon footprint of the coil coating industry. And our efforts, the University of Port Harcourt applied for a patent in 2012 because I was at the University of Port Harcourt as a visiting professor under the lead scheme, that is linkages with experts and academics in the diaspora scheme by NUC. So when we did that, University of Port Harcourt authorities, they appreciated our efforts in doing this thing within 1 year, and the patent that was issued is somewhere around there. However, I will tell you something. To innovate and come up with a credible solution which partially cuts down on the carbon footprint of metal finishing industries required a lot of laboratory work and intuitive reasoning, which was achieved when God allowed it. Many researchers may have tried and did not succeed. However, we go back to the Bible once more, and we say in Psalm 127, verse 2, it is written, and I quote, "It is in vain to wake up early to sleep late, to eat the bread of sorrow, because God gives all these things to his beloved, even while they are sleeping." To those who walk with God and try to emulate Jesus Christ in his deeds and thoughts, it is natural for God to reveal what to do and the direction to go. Because in Isaiah chapter 45, verse 3, God says, "And I will give thee the treasures of darkness and hidden riches of sweet places, that thou mayest know that I, the Lord, which call thee by thy name, am the God of Israel." So we were lucky once more. God revealed the direction to go, and we arrived at the patents. And what did we do with the patents? We have now put the product into the Nigerian market by the company under the leadership of my dear wife, Mrs. Suki. And we are selling the product as key codes. It's in the Nigerian market. We have commercialized it. Praise God. So like I said, the coating dried faster than normal coating, and we were able to cut all the unnecessary things. And that's the patent, right? Thus, with the use of an agricultural product, the carbon footprint of the metal finishing industry was reduced by more than a half. And in the foreseeable future, it is likely that the breaded chromates will be replaced by extracts from plant origin. We have seen commercialized it and decided by Mrs. SM. So the future, during my introduction, probably I skipped it. I said within my professional concerns, I will look into what we have done, what we met on ground, what we have done, and break the way to go. So the way to go, I have told you what we have done, what we met on the ground. The way to go, the first step is to compound acceptable compositions containing both inorganic and organic green inhibitors, so that prolonged excellent performance in aggressive media can be achieved. This is in Ecuador. If we want to make use of agricultural products to the fullest, we have to do that. Then there is this other one, the formation of MOFs, that's metal organic frameworks. What are metal organic frameworks? You have something like aluminium as metal. Organic materials could be extracts from plants, which are inhibitors. We can maneuver them in solution in one manner or the other. Encourage them to plate on aluminium. What are these MOFs? They are porous in nature. Because of their porosity, you can make use of them as catalysts. Catalyst in carbon dioxide capture. Because to break carbon dioxide down, the energy required is so high. So if you have a catalyst that can encourage the breakage of carbon dioxide, then you are contributing to reduction in carbon footprint. You are reducing, removing carbon dioxide from probably your immediate environment. However, remember that you need carbon dioxide photosynthesis to take place. But in some certain situations, you want to cut down on the carbon dioxide being released into the environment. The total replacement of chromates must be achieved within the next few years. How do we achieve this? Others have been working. Almost all military formations, I don't know about the Nigerian military, but then in the UK and the US, they are in the forefront. I mean, the military, they are in the forefront of removing chromates as inorganic inhibitors. And I tell you, from what I have gone through, by 2019, the use of chromates is going to be stopped. So I know that the replacement is just within an arm's reach. And in our laboratory here, we too, we are still at the trail of replacing the chromates. What have we done? We have looked at permanganate solutions. We have been able to form a conversion coating on aluminium, which is golden colored. We tested it, and what did we get? At least it was better than pure aluminium. Than unpainted or uncoated aluminium, but it is not as good as the chromate. We may go ahead to add tannin or whatever to it, and probably that will improve on its corrosion resistance. And not only that, we are going to make use of some electron optic devices and analytical instruments. And by the time we complete that job, God willing, we are going to have an international patent from the platform of Landmark University. So in conclusion, I will say that agricultural inputs in Cohesion Studies and Control are on the upward swing. Extracts from various parts of plants are now being employed in the control of the rate of degradation of steel reinforced concrete, as well as metal alloys in several situations. Yes, you know you have cohesion in reinforcements. Although we cannot see any sign of it in this building because it is well built. But in some places, you look at some bridges, you can see the iron rods rusting and the concrete swelling and flaking off. However, to reduce that sort of corrosion, what we normally do is put inhibitors in the concrete mix. I have gone through some PhD thesis where they performed tests on concrete mixed with inhibitors extracted from plants and the rest of it, and they performed admirably well. So it's on the upward swing, the use of extracts from various plants. The carbon footprint of the treatment section of the process of coil coating has been cut down by more than a half by the combination of turning a polyhydroxy extract from plant roots. Like I have just described it, we use tanning mixed with chromate. It gave us a beautiful result, which is being used in the industries as of today. So, input in cohesion studies is well, and it is moving up higher. The control of corrosion rates of steel in acidic media have been achieved by the use of extracts from agricultural products, such as onion skin. Onion skin, you know the onion skin. It's not edible, it's a waste. But you can extract tannin from it, and the tannin, you use it in so many situations. And pawpaw leaf, Caringa papaya, the leaf too has been used to reduce corrosion rate of steel in several media. Appreciable impact is being made through the commercialization of our findings. I have just told you, first was my PhD finding. In the early 90s, we sold it at Solmaco. And the current one, we are selling it at Kimwood. The research into permanganate-based conversion coating chemical will be completed in the nearest future. I just mentioned that I and some of my colleagues in the Department of Mechanical Engineering, we have been able to develop a conversion coating similar to the chromate coating, because it is golden in color. It reduces the corrosion rate of aluminum, and it may replace the chromate. With electrochemical testing procedures and advanced analytical techniques, such as electrospectroscopy for chemical analysis, that's ESCA, which otherwise known as SPS, and OGM electrospectroscopy, ADS, we are going to employ these analytical instruments to further study the coating so that we can be fair and say, yes, these are the results. Once you make use of these electrochemical techniques and advanced analytical techniques, you can be bold anywhere in the world and say, go and try it. It's not just dipping metal inside sodium chloride and say, take photograph and say, this. No, you need to use some specific analytical instruments and some chemical techniques so that it can be an affirmative research. Now, before I go to sit down, Chancellor, sir, the Vice Chancellor, I wish to acknowledge. And I'll start by saying that I am grateful to the Holy Spirit upon which Christianity solidly rests. The three persons in one God, God the Father, God the Son, God the Holy Spirit. God has been wonderful and performed great things in my life, in my family. He alone deserves the adoration. glory and honor for making today's discourse a reality. I also seize this opportunity to show appreciation to my wife and our three children. They have been wonderful in their support and clear-cut uprightness without giving us any anxious moments in their studies and livelihoods. All glory belongs to God. On behalf of the Department of Mechanical Engineering and the College of Science and Engineering, I express my deep appreciation to the Chancellor, Dr. David O. Oyedepo, the Vice Chancellor, Professor Isaac Obanion, the immediate past president, Pastor Daniel A. Otin, PhD. The current registrar, Pastor Dr. John Isabel, and the entire management crew of Landmark University for giving me the opportunity to deliver the third inaugural lecture of this great citadel of learning, where we break new grounds every day. Furthermore, I appreciate the Vice Chancellor of and Management of the University of Connecticut and the National Universities Commission for their support during my lead scholarship, the outcome of which forms a part of this discourse. I really enjoy the companionship of my friends during this period, and I appreciate that support. To my brothers and sisters and their families, Pastor Aki Uki and family, Mr. and Mrs. Solomon and family, Engineer Dayo Uki and family, my in-laws, especially Chief Mike Lubin, Windobi, MVI. You may wish to know the meaning of MVI. Most valuable in-law. A round of applause. I say thank you. To my friends from Agbara Estates, Group Captain and Mrs. John Ojibutu, retired but not tired. Mr. and Mrs. Silva Umole, Mr. and Mrs. Darwin Allegheny, I appreciate all of your support, encouragement, and sense of humor. Professor Tonye Ekine, Professor Urubite Alaboy, and others from Unicourt, I say thank you. To my colleagues at the Department of Mechanical Engineering, most especially engineers, they are taking on Bamitele Okushe, P. Ikubani Abuola, Kuleko Mulafe, Kotoki, and Tony Onokwa. I say thank you for your support. My dearest Dean, Dr. John Ogenion, I appreciate you. I thank all of you wonderful people and friends, numerous to mention it to me, who have come from far and near to grace this occasion. I appreciate you. The Vice Chancellor, academic and non-academic colleagues, kings and queens of Landmark University, distinguished ladies and gentlemen, There will be no lecture without all of you good people being present. So I say a big thank you. Lastly, I will leave you with the words of Einstein. He says, the world is not dangerous because of those who do harm, but because of those who look at it without doing anything. We have looked at the oil coating industry. They are harming the environment, and we did not sit on the fence and watch. We went into action. We've been able to reduce their carbon footprint. So if we all do so in our little corners, in our small corners, we'll be adding a lot to reducing carbon footprint and the rest of it. And I will also say again, there is an admonishment from a wonderful fellow that I met once at Covenant University and again at this place, that's Landmark University. He's no other person than Pastor Dr. Daniel A. Roti. He once acknowledged and said, without Stephen, the world would not have had Apostle Paul. What does that mean? Apostle Paul, before he was converted, he led those that were persecuting Stephen. They killed Stephen. But before he died, he said, God should forgive them. So he says, always forgive those who do harm to you. I rest my case here and I say a big thank you to you all for listening.
Please, you may be seated. What an engaging lecture. The Chancellor, sir, we have so many distinguished Nigerians who have come from far and near to grace this occasion. And it's time to begin to recognize them. We have in our midst Professor A.C. Achilume from King's University. You're welcome, sir. We have Dr. Gabriel Genio from Adelike University. We have Mrs. Becky C.A. from Agbara Estate, Lagos. We have Mr. Oki and Jola Jesu from Lagos too. They are members of the family. We also have Mr. Fabi, the principal at Delta College. Right here. You're welcome, sir. We also have Mr. Adifarin Olusegun from Government Secondary School, Omu-Aran. We also have Dr. Orodo from Covenant University. We also have Mr. Olorunntele Olaruwanju from Federal University, New York. As we move on, we will also recognize more of our distinguished guests. The Chancellor, sir, may I at this juncture
respectfully invite the Vice Chancellor of Landmark University, who is also representing the Chancellor of this great university, Dr. Dembe Edebo, to give the Chancellor's remarks. The Vice Chancellor. Please, you may rise because she is representing the Chancellor of this great university, Dr. Dembe Edebo.
May you please be seated. On behalf of the Chancellor, Landmark University, Dr. David Edebo, I request us all to please join me as we again put our hands together, appreciating the third inaugural lecturer of Landmark University. Engineer Professor O'Kee, congratulations. That was a succinctly delivered lecture. I am stepping into oversized shoes. How do you begin to speak the mind of the vision with respect to that which we have been treated to in today's lecture, the tripodal connection, man, material, and environment. And I'm talking about none other than the Chancellor of Landmark University, Dr. David Oladipo. Along the vision lines of Landmark University, talking about our emergence in the not so distant future of becoming a leading world-class university, our commitment to spearheading an Agrarian revolution, digging up the treasures in Mother Earth, and restoring the dignity of the black man. Today's lecture has been so centered, so situated in addressing the realization of a vision in education, and not just a vision at that, but revolutionary steps towards our emergence on the world-class platform. May I say that Professor O'Kee has delivered, true to his promise, relaying the truth in very concise statements, noting that even in presenting the third inaugural lecture, the tripod, talking about the Trinity, is so well captured. And this fully situates that which we represent as a university, talking about a Christian mission emphasis. All through the lecture, we see God appearing on almost all the pages. And if it is not man over matter, body over materials, and God over the universe, I don't know what else this lecture has addressed. To my mind, again looking from the visionary base, man's dominion over materials and how to inhibit the aging process, the process of corruption. I am tempted to look at the seasons of a man's life and also noting that yes, maintenance is part of that. We go back to the Garden of Eden. God put man there to have dominion. He said, take charge and have dominion. Keep the garden and dress it. The inhibitors that have been talked about, the corrosion process talked about, is man's own way of keeping and dressing the garden and also promoting sustainability across all the human species talking about the survival of man's, God's own creation. This particular lecture, to my mind, fulfills the vision quest as has been presented by the Chancellor Landmark University. It is not about the findings of research for its own sake. It is the application of research findings. And that is where Landmark University comes in. And definitely the work that has been done with respect to reducing the carbon footprints definitely is a major breakthrough in all the forays that have been described. Can we again congratulate Professor O'Keefe for the awesome breakthroughs in research, identifying applications for research, and working with God's own endowment, talking about materials. This is actually a return to Eden lecture, and that which God has endowed in man, and making sure that research findings find their reality in giving expressions in that which man, in talking about his dominion mandate, is able to definitely engage with. May I say that the breakthroughs, particularly in seeking alternatives to chromates, is a major one indeed. We are glad on the Landmark University context and platform to have Professor O'Keefe not just arrive on the professorate platform and hang up his boots, but he is saying that even international patents will soon emerge from the Landmark University context. The research efforts, as we have listened to the contributions from the third inaugural lecture, is certainly solution-driven, innovative, definitely talking about exploits in research and breakthroughs that have led to incubation and commercialization, and definitely also enterprise, and definitely also adding value. You could see that his most valued wife had to be the general manager of the company that was floated by him. She did not have to be an employee under any organization. I thought we were putting our hands together. This is what research, particularly research that is devoid of just doing it for the sake of research, research for its own sake, particularly noting the African agenda driving solutions and the African arising to address issues of concern. We must sing our own songs. We must find solutions to our indigenous challenges. No one will do it for us. I see today's lecture as coming full circle in all of these parameters. As we go looking into the future, particularly noting what agriculture is able to give, it's beyond food security. This lecture is also talking about human security matters, how to drive longevity, how to reduce the carcinogenic materials, how to improve the human condition all around. Many times we would have looked at agricultural contributions as only driving food security matters, but from this lecture, even from pawpaw leaves, even from onion bulbs, even from onion skins, we are able to get into research into phytochemical plants and how this is able to serve as inhibitors against the corrosion process. Definitely from his conclusions, we may not be able to go totally organic. Research will still be able to go out on the limb on that. However, we have come to a point from that which has been emphasized in today's inaugural lecture, that there is so much that can be derived in reducing the corruption process by engaging materials in agricultural platforms. And this is a major breakthrough indeed, by taking agricultural research to new levels and to next levels. Interesting trajectories are represented here, particularly as we note the commercial dimension of this research and that which universities must keep embracing. With research endeavors such as this, IGR dimensions are not too far-fetched by reason of that which we see in terms of what this particular research effort and research efforts over the years portends. Inaugural lectures such as this are times where we are able to also touch on the emotions. As I listened to the various platforms where Professor Oki has made his contributions, we see that it has not only been within the university context, it has been a meeting of town and gown, and town and industry, and university across the tribunal connections. Again, I congratulate on behalf of the Chancellor of Landmark University, Professor Oki, and commend this groundbreaking efforts, and this is indeed directions that research should go. A university context such as ours will never be complete without looking at the journey, a journey that started as we received his citation and now going into the field of materials and corrosion engineering. Let me say that our emphasis through our research clusters and through our visionary quests is on finding solutions towards developments agriculture is able to drive in national development plans. And from this lecture, we see a journey of discovery and enlightenment. It is exciting that Professor Makonjola Oki's work addresses many key plaques in universities' drive for excellence, particularly landmark universities' drive for excellence. May I therefore, as I conclude the Chancellor's remarks on this occasion, note that his work is awesomely seminal, and as we engage the tripartite connections, man, material, and environment, agricultural inputs to corrosion, Professor Makonjola Oki showcases Landmark University's focus to attain new frontiers in driving an agrarian revolution. He has definitely justified his formal entry today into the professorate, the crucial role of agricultural inputs in corrosion, inhibiting that process, and situating the responsibility that man must embrace in reducing corrosion rates of materials and extending their useful lifespan via a maintenance culture. If there has been any challenge, if there have been issues with the way we have engaged with the construction industry and all industries as we have them represented in this nation, it is the need to embrace a maintenance culture. And whether it is materials, and whether it is man, the effect of corrosion is real. And this lecture has woken in us a consciousness for us to take this to the next level. This has been a wonderful outing again for Landmark University, and it's interesting that the third inaugural lecture is addressing to other matters, and we cannot at all ignore the role of the Creator, the role of the Maker, the one that has continued to give us breath in our nostrils and giving us every reason to engage with our Dominion status. On this note, we again celebrate the Chancellor Landmark University for visionary insights in making contributions, and not just regular contributions, but revolutionary contributions to what a university is able to be as we consider new frontiers in driving an agrarian revolution from Landmark University. Again, join me to congratulate the lecturer for today, Professor Mark Androla. May I again appreciate everyone that have come from near and far, distinguished professors, representatives of vice chancellors, the wonderful family, the most valuable in-law. That's a new one for us at Landmark University, and I'm also extending that to the most valuable wife, Mrs. Sobari Makojuola Oki. Thank you all, and God bless you.
Put your hands together for that beautiful address. Please, you may have your seats. Hey, Chancellor, sir, may I also continue with the recognition of important Nigerians that have graced this occasion? We have in our midst Professor Emeko Anlatise, is the Dean, College of Faculty of Engineering, Federal University of Technology at Graham. We also have Professor Oladuwe Adeyemi from Rejima University. We also have Professor A.K.O. Orubite from University of Connecticut. We also have Dr. Ayodeji Salami from Ekiti State University. We also have Pastor Oyebamiji Jebu from Jesus is Alive Church. We also have Mr. Omokola Oladimeji Osmo from Apparel Comprehensive School. We also have in our midst Mrs. Mohammed Hadizat from Korea in Lawrenceville. You're welcome. We have Engineer Abdulkadir Motala from Nigerian Society of Engineers. We also have Engineer Adebija J.A. from UCA in Lawrenceville. We also have in our midst Group Captain John Ojikutu, retired. We also have Lady Patricia Omo. We also have Mr. Adeboye Abiodun. We also have Engineer Taiwo Olashin from Korean Office in London. We also have Engineer J.S. Adebayo, Nigerian Society of Engineers in London. We also have Engineer M.A. Akonmi from Nigerian Society of Engineers in London. We also have in our midst Pastor Praise Olufemi, Union Faith Church in London. At this juncture of the Chancellor, may we take good messages. After that, I will continue the recognition of our university. May I
call on. But before I do that, let me also inform this distinguished assembly that we have some secondary schools represented here. We have a Apera Comprehensive College, New Rise Revolution, students from Apera Comprehensive School, welcome to Lanman University, New Rise University. We also have students from the alma mater of our Chancellor, Government Secondary School of Omu-Aran. Please rise for our students. We also have students from Landmark University Secondary School. Please rise for the vision. Landmark University Secondary School. We also have students from Omu-Aran High School. Finally, we have students from Adult College of Omu-Aran. Please rise for them. It is time for the representatives. I will invite the representative of the Vice Chancellor of Covenant University, Dr. Oroku Odi, for his good message. Dr.
The Chancellor, sir, the Vice Chancellor, I bring greetings from the Vice Chancellor of Covenant University and the entire community in Covenant University. I've known Professor Oki for a while, and I will say the inaugural lecture is not just a lecture, but he has taught us, and it was a good lecture from him. I would like to say, being a petroleum engineer first and foremost, I would like to see products that will prevent corrosion applied to all the pipelines in the South, as this will actually prevent us from spending so much by importing products from outside the country. Thank you very much.
Thank you, sir. May I invite Professor A.C. Achulume from King's University for his inaugural message. Chancellor, sir. I, Professor A.C. Achulume, Dean Faculty of Science, representing my Vice Chancellor, Professor Famurewa of King's University, wish to congratulate you on the third inaugural lecture and to acknowledge the academic skill that you have for Land University. I personally want to congratulate Professor Makwajolaki. And I want to wish you greater success in your academic career. Thank you, and God bless.
Thank you, sir.
May I recognize Professor S.U. Ayeson, and at the same time invite him for his good message. He's representing Bowen Teaching Bowen University.
Chancellor, sir, Vice Chancellor, ma'am, I have known Professor Oki since our days in the University of Benin. And when I saw on his WhatsApp page that he was having this is coming, but I'm glad that I listened to this lecture. It's very erudite, and I'm very pleased to see him after such a long time, since we live in West Elmabed. And this is very good, and also to wish you success in your further careers. Thank you very much.
Thank you, sir. May I quickly announce that at the end of this event, there is a cocktail party for invited guests and members of the university. And the venue is in the cafeteria of three. Let me also invite Professor Olarere Adeyemi of Redeemer's University for
the Chancellor, the Vice Chancellor, Professor Isaiah Obai. My name is Professor Olalere Adeyemi. Behalf of the Vice Chancellor of Redeemer University, Professor Zed Dibo Adeyewa, greetings. He promised to be here. He gave his word when we met in Abuja. But there was a crucial university agreement at the moment going on in his university. So he called me yesterday that I should be here unfailingly, and that's why I'm here. I want to congratulate the university, and especially I want to congratulate the inaugural lecturer of the day, Professor Oki. I really enjoy myself, because as an applied chemist myself, I'm in a familiar terrain. I can completely say that really contributes a lot to knowledge. Once again, congratulations. Thank you very much, and God bless.
Thank you, sir, for those kind words. May I invite Professor Orobite for his good message. Come on, sir.
Thank you. Vice Chancellor, ma'am. And the Chancellor, sir. I'm very happy being here. As a matter of fact, when Oki called me about October last year, I would come for his inaugural lecture, I said yes. And one of the major reasons I came here was to see what Landmark University looks like. We were together in the University of Benin, then he was one year my senior in educational chemistry, red industrial chemistry. Then we were together in the University of Port Harcourt. Then he came back again on the second journey as a diaspora fellow to the University of Port Harcourt, and we were together too. He has been a very mobile person in terms of labor, and I'm happy. I've seen the Landmark University, and I tell you, I'm quite impressed. In a short notice, this is your third inaugural lecture, and I know that some state universities that have existed for 15, 20 years have not been able to go to the 10th inaugural lecture. I'm very, very happy, and the intellectual line, your key point that you are focusing on is interesting. And I think today, my friend, I've added one very good, I won't call it feather, I would call it a plume to your cap. Thank you very much.
Thank you, sir. May I also recognize Mrs. Okisuza. You're welcome. I recognize also Mrs. Okilo. Okilo. You're welcome. We also have in our list Mr. Silva Mole. You're welcome, sir. You're welcome. We also have Engineer Friday Ape. We have Engineer Ese Ochoga. You're welcome, sir. We also have Mr. Paul Ochoga. You're welcome. We also have Engineer P. Elisha in our midst. Ladies and gentlemen, let me quickly invite Group Captain John Ojikutu for his goodwill message. The Group Captain. Welcome to the podium.
I think I'm very much delighted to be among the list of academicians. By profession, I'm a military man. I left service about 26 years ago. I have been a friend to Dr. Oki for the period I have lived in Agbara State over 20 years. And like I said, I'm very much happy to be in the ministry. And like the professor from Morocco said, I think what I have seen about Landmark, like I told colleagues, there is much more a peaceful and probably a scenic environment than what I saw in Covenant. And I really want to congratulate the Chancellor, or the founder of this university, for the job he has done so far. I'm very much happy for Professor Okin today. Like I said, I'm not an academician, but from the lecture he has given today, I think he has enriched my knowledge about what the environment is all about and what amount of degradation a lot of us have been doing to the environment. And I wish we are going to learn a lot from the lecture of today, so that we can contribute our own quota to the environment so that we do not degrade it worse than where it is today. So on behalf of my wife is not here, I want to congratulate Professor Oki once again. Well done.
Thank you, sir. May I invite the principal of the alma mater of our chancellor, Mr. Abifarin Olushe, for his goodness. Put your hands together. The Chancellor, my Vice Chancellor, distinguished guests, I want to congratulate the lecturer today for a most rewarding contribution to academics. The lecture really has thrown more light into the environment and offers solution to degradation. We just hope that the students will take a cue and form a team to fight environmental degradation. Once again, I congratulate you, sir. Thank you very much. Thank you, sir.
Thank you, sir, once again. The good news messages will continue during the cocktail party. At this juncture, I invite Dr. John Bojedro for the word of thanks. The Dean, College of Science and Engineering.
The Chancellor, sir. The Vice Chancellor. I think the Vice Chancellor has successfully summed up this inaugural lecture today, the tripodal connection, man, material, and environment, and that in each of these, corrosion definitely occurs. Thank you very much. On behalf of the Vice Chancellor, Professor Isaiah Wine, management, faculty, staff, and students of Landmark University, we wish to express our profound gratitude, first and foremost, to God Almighty for His unfailing love and goodness to us as a university, and for making this stone inaugural lecture the second from the College of Science and Engineering a huge success. He alone has been our help. To God alone be all the glory. And to our dear Chancellor, who is unavoidably absent today, Dr. David Oyedepo, for his unwavering support to the Agrarian mandate of this university and commitment to excellence, we are eternally grateful. To our distinguished guests, family and friends of our inaugural lecture, and all well-wishers who have come from far and near, we say thank you for your presence, your prayer, which has made this occasion a success. Bon voyage as you return. Thank you and thank you again. To our host community, Omu-Aran and environment, we are grateful for the cooperation and acceptance over the years, which has made the town and gown synergy feasible. May the land continue to enjoy peace and progress. We say thank you. Worthy of note is the ceremonies committee for your tireless effort in putting this great event together. Your labor shall not go unrewarded. Thank you very much. The Publications Committee, ably chaired by Professor Lucas, for a job well done, we appreciate you too. And finally, to our inaugural lecturer, Engineer Professor Makaju Olaoke, whose calm disposition truly reflects his name. Today is a milestone achievement, both for you and for the College of Science and Engineering and the entire Landmark University. You have done us proud. Your case is truly different. More grace in Jesus' name. Let me quickly wrap up this by saying, the Chancellor Dr. David Oyedepo, who is unavoidably absent, has sent his greetings to this August gathering. Once again, to every one of us, we say thank you. Shalom.